It's a delight this afternoon to welcome Robert Pope to talk to us. Robert needs very little introduction. Robert's currently acting as principal of Westminster College and has long been associated with the United Reformed Church History Society, indeed edits the journal. Robert has a long and distinguished career as a historian and theologian, having taught for a good number of years in various places in Wales before landing here in Cambridge. And it's wonderful to have Robert reflecting on simply Wales and the United Reformed Church. Now, I'm told that this little microphone should be theoretically connected to a loop system if anyone did want to attempt to use a loop system. This one magnifies and this one does the loop, so we'll now attach this one to Robert and Robert can set off. So thank you very much, Robert.
These days as acting principal that I have very little time to act as a historian, and I find that when I am expected to act as a historian, I usually find myself apologising beforehand that what was probably in your mind coming into this session was not in my mind, and what was in my mind wasn't what I've actually done. And this was because I simply ran out of time. But anyway, we'll go with what I've got and see where we get. October 1972 is remembered in some quarters in Wales as the month in which the New Zealand All Blacks rugby team were defeated 9-3 by Llanelli, rather than for the inauguration of the United Reformed Church. I have vague memories of the way in which the Scarlet's victory was mythologized in the 1970s, by no less a person than Max Boyce, of course, in as much the same way as I recall being told by my mother that we were going to be taken to the new church, and wondering if it was new, why did it look so old? Before thinking about the URC in Wales, I want to point to three areas in particular where I think there's been a sea change in the Welsh experience during the past 50 years. There could be others, but these three I think are important because they give a backdrop to the life of the URC in Wales in the last 50 years. In 1972, first of all, it probably seemed at best unlikely that Wales would have a devolved assembly. Downright hostility to the idea was confirmed when the first referendum on devolution was overwhelmingly defeated in 1979. The referendum to establish a devolved assembly was hardly a resounding victory. The votes all amounted to 50.3%. This reflects a gradual change, though, in national identity, from one that revolved primarily around a perceived common culture to one which relates more to politics and economics. That all may be somewhat oversimplistic, but it holds some truth, and the URC in Wales has grown alongside this development. Second, at the beginning of 1972, there was a UK-wide strike of coal miners. Their campaign proved successful, and few would have confidently predicted that the coal industry would be decimated within 30 to 40 years. The sea change over half a century is not revolved simply around the loss of heavy industry, including coal, but the call to discard fossil fuel completely because of its detrimental effect on the environment. New businesses did come to Wales as the coal field was being closed down, most notably in electronics, but these developments took place alongside the M4 and A55 corridors. Many of the valley communities lost much and gained nothing, and around a quarter of the population now lives below the poverty line. These are the very places that have seen the greatest decline in religious attendance and the greatest number of church closures. Third, we need to acknowledge that the fortunes and status of the Welsh language have been transformed during these 50 years. According to data collected in the 1971 census, Welsh speakers aged 3 and over numbered just over 500,000 and accounted for 20.7% of the population. According to the annual population survey in 2021, there were over 890,000 people over 3 years old who were Welsh speaking or claimed to know some knowledge of the language, amounting to just under 30% of the population. The increase in Welsh medium education over the last 50 years has given us the primary reason for this growth, and this has also seen a change in the geographical concentration of Welsh speakers. There are now greater numbers of Welsh speakers in the southeast than in the traditional heartlands of the north and southwest. While a small number of URC congregations have either been bilingual or have provided Welsh medium worship, these are a minority. URC is predominantly an English-speaking denomination, but it has existed in a bilingual context, and its ecumenical work has put it alongside denominations that are bilingual, denominations that have Welsh and English congregations, and denominations that are predominantly Welsh-speaking. There are national, though not established, churches, and these work alongside churches such as the URC, that belongs to other parts of Great Britain. That, of course, is true of how the URC exists in England and Scotland as well. But the Scottish experience may be similar to the Welsh. The English experience is rather different because of the dominance of the Church of England. This inevitably means English ecumenism has a different feel. But the fact that the URC is so predominantly an English, England-based church occasionally impacts on decisions made in 1972 and confirmed since, that the Welsh province and then synod might have to work in a different direction, one that suits its context rather than suits the wider URC. Wales has not had an established church since 1920, though I think someone forgot to tell the church in Wales. The ecumenical scene in Wales is then very different from that of England. One final point, and these numbers are a little skewed because they're rather old now, but the most recent census data that's currently available reveal that over 93% of the population of Wales self-identify as white British. Around two-thirds of the population identify themselves as Welsh. Over half the population claim to be Christian, but around 4.8% and drop-in of the population attend church regularly. Despite increases in Welsh speakers, English remains the language spoken by the majority, and at the last census, the next greatest language group was the Poles, with 5%, 2% speak in Arabic, and almost 2% Bengali. Now to the URC more specifically. In 1972, the moderator of the province of Wales was the Reverend William John Samuel, universally known as Bill Sam. He trained for ministry in Wales at Brecon's Memorial College, although his ministry was in Wales. In 1962, he became moderator of the Wales and Monmouthshire province of the Congregation of the Union of Wales, and he continued as the moderator of the province of Wales in the URC in 1977. The one factor which seems to have been resolved there is that by 1972, Monmouthshire was confirmed to be part of Wales. Apparently, he had convinced many of the churches in Wales and Monmouthshire to join the URC because there won't be any difference. We are the same people wearing different hats. He was not entirely persuasive, and a number of churches either declined to join or were admitted to the denomination after his inauguration having failed to achieve the required majority in the initial vote. The history of my home church, what was Manserton United Reformed Church and is now known as Christwell, is instructive at this point. There appears to have been a strong sense of independence prominence among the church leadership, but an attraction to union among the membership. So a church meeting in February 1966 voted to be an associated rather than a full member of the Congregational Church in England and Wales. When it was decided that associate members could vote on whether or not to join the new Reformed Church, the deacons recommended that the church meeting in February 1971 vote against its formation and instruct the Manserton representatives of the Assembly of the Congregational Church to do the same. The Congregational Church Assembly having voted to unite with the Presbyterian Church of England, the Manserton Church then had to vote on whether or not to join the United Reformed Church. So in a vote on the 15th of September 1971, with 165 out of 391 members present, 122 voted for and 41 voted against. You can see that the votes for are 74.85%, therefore 0.15% short of the 75% majority required, and the meeting resolved not to join the United Reformed Church. Their figures might disguise the reality. Tensions were reaching breaking point in the congregation, and a special church meeting was held on the 29th of September when the minister, the Reverend Fred Norton, announced, "I believe the future must be within the new Reformed Church." I always wonder whether that's the Holy Spirit exiting. Mr. Norden, as ministers were referred to in those days, reflected the view of the majority, of course. Though nailing his colours to the mast in this way might have been seen as him exerting undue pressure on the minority who were against union, even if it was unintended. He'd been minister for almost 10 years, and during that time, membership had grown by almost 100 people. Though I have to say that anecdotally, it was said that very few of them had been baptised. Well, we heard that before. Those present may have thought that he was not in any case going to remain in the church much longer, and that a move would be precipitated if they stayed after the URC. In fact, he did only stay another 2 years. But for whatever reason, and I think the main one would be the frustration of the clear majority, a second ballot was held on the 26th of March 1972. You can see here 156 members present voted to join, 45 voted against. However, the second vote had taken place prior to the formation of the URC, and the Charity Commission was deemed it illegal. I think that maybe got the straw a little bit, but it was invalid, I guess. So a third vote was taken on the 17th of December. This time there was again an insufficient majority. So a special deacons meeting was held after morning worship on the 7th of January 1973, when it was resolved to ask the church meeting that evening, in light of the disunity in the church over the question of joining the United Reformed Church, the diaconate asks the minority if it is not possible to join with the majority. The diaconate recommends, therefore, that a further ballot be taken. It seems that the membership had been encouraged to turn up in force, with this being the highest attendance at any of the four meetings. The church meeting, 206 members voted against and 26 against. There were three abstentions. The church then applied to join the URC, and the application was formally accepted during the session of the General Assembly on the 7th of May 1973. What that means in practice, of course, is that the church will celebrate 50 years of the URC this year and 50 years of being part of it next year.
Robert, I think one of your numbers is wrong there. The percentage on vote for, surely.
Don't tell me that, because this is the official thing that was recorded. Don't tell me that we didn't really vote to join.
No, she didn't vote to join. Your percentage is We'll move on.
Sessions when John Ellis was trying to explain the budget to me. I don't even know what you're talking about, but it doesn't go in. So Manchester's history highlights two important aspects of the quest for organic union, apart from the fact we can't do percentages. The first, rather generally, is the cruel irony that the desire for union has the unintended but apparently unavoidable consequence of division. There were some who were unwilling to accept the wishes of the majority, and some people left the church. On a larger scale, the successive votes to form the Congregational Church in England and Wales and then the elected Reformed Church required churches which had previously been in communion potentially to separate from each other. Statistics could be read in different ways, but of the 276 churches listed in the final Congregational Yearbook of 1972, 91 were not listed in the URC's interim yearbook, and it was 75 of them were not listed in the first full URC book in 1973. There were, of course, others that were listed in 1965, but were no longer listed in 1966. Experience in Wales was the painful one where fellowship ceased with those not insignificant number of churches with 4 digits outside the URC. Even John Morgan's usually very diplomatic, had to acknowledge that 1972 marked a schism in Congregationalism in Wales. Mm-hmm. This points to the significance of identity and how much was invested by Congregationalists, even when at times this was understood in a particular idiosyncratic way. This can be seen in an open letter that was written by the Reverend Trevor Lloyd Evans, who was General Secretary of the Union of Welsh Independence, to John Huxtable in 1971. I'm always puzzled by this open letter because it was published in the Welsh Independent newspaper, a Tist, in Welsh. I'm guessing he sent an English version to John Huxtable. He wrote in it that the inauguration of the United Reformed Church would spell the end of Congregationalism. It's almost certain that this sense was shared by many Congregationalists and many Congregationalists in Wales, some of whom were clearly inspired to make the sacrifice. It's equally certain that Presbyterians were concerned that their system would be compromised by what they perceived to be ecclesiastical anarchy. Much revolves then around what Congregationalism represents. It appears that for Trevor Lloyd Evans, the essence of Congregationalism is in free thought and freedom of conscience. This led him to object to the inclusion of the statement of faith in the proposed basis of union, on the grounds that this Trinitarianism would exclude Unitarians and members of the Society of Friends. Huxtable responded, I haven't been able to check whether it was published in Welsh or in English, but he did respond by saying that the local church could not be left to exist without wider association with other churches, and he underlined his axiomatic belief in the need for organic union. I haven't been able to go back and look at it and check whether he says anything about the Trinitarian statement or not. Inasmuch as it's possible at all to speak generally about it, Welsh Congregationalism, both English and Welsh speaking, tended to locate its origins in English separatism. This is reflected perhaps in the fact that most Welsh speaking churches are known as independent rather than congregational churches. And as an aside here, when we arranged to translate Tudor Jones's History of the Welsh Independence into English and give it the title Congregationalism in Wales to sit alongside his earlier Congregationalism in England, one irate reviewer wrote, I am not a Congregationalist, I am an independent, and I'd be an independent until I die. The founders of Congregationalism in Wales were the Welsh, whose faith came under Puritan influence. And as it developed, it grew and looked to homegrown leaders. Many South Wales churches began as church plants or mission stations provided by Welsh-speaking churches. This is true to some degree in North Wales, but Congregationalism was not as strong there, and there was some influence from Lancashire because well-to-do Congregationalists supported the institution of Congregation churches in their preferred holiday destinations. But this sense of independence in Congregationalism lingered, and I'm not sure there was much understanding of what reform meant. Theologically, I'm not that sure there's much understanding of what it means today. Now, maybe that was true in parts of England too, but there was at least an alternative narrative in Congregationalism in England, which concerned Calvin's Geneva. I illustrate the point by referencing my home church again. I recall something of a shock in the late 1970s when the minister was called led worship in cassock, gown, bands, and academic hood. I notice that doesn't seem shocking to you. The minister in question was Ivor Rees, who would be known to some of you, and is a member of the society. Ivor trained at the Memorial College in Brecon in the late 1950s. He came to Manchester having spent 5 years at Clapham and 6 years at Ewell. No one seems to have come across a Congregationalist leading worship in Geneva and Gard before, and I remember someone saying that while he was in England, he'd become an Anglican. I asked him, and he told me he'd become interested in the apparent rediscovery of a highly reformed view of the church and of its ministry, associated with you-know-who, Nathaniel Mitchum, John Selden Will, Bernard Old Manning, Samuel Jenkins, John Huxtable and others. While he'd been a student at Brecon, he hadn't discovered it in England. He'd learned it while he was a student. And when he was ordained in a Welsh independent church in Port Talbot, he wore full robes. He also persuaded Penna Davis, who was the principal of the college, to do the same. It might be the first and last time that Penna wore it. Ivor thought he looked uncomfortable. There are exceptions to the rule, but on the whole, Congregation in Wales, in both languages, was that which navigated more to separatism than Geneva. The Congregationalism lingered in the province of Wales, it probably still there. My church was known as Congre right up until the point it was demolished and rebuilt. Indeed, there's some evidence to suggest that nothing much changed, and therefore Samuel's description of the same people wearing different hats was at least initially the case. His success as moderator subsequently wrote, the scheme of union, which has been passed by Act of Parliament, I don't know whether you thought that gave it added authority, which has been passed by Act of Parliament, was not introduced in Wales. According to the newly inaugurated United Reformed Church interim yearbook for 1972-73, there were 156 churches that were located in the province of Wales. Of these, only three had belonged to the Presbyterian Church of England. The oldest was St Andrews in Swansea. You could only get a photo of it after it had closed and become quite derelict. But you can get the picture of what the Presbyterians in Swansea thought of themselves. The other two were in Cardiff, so Windsor Place, which is now City Church, established in 1865, and North Park, which was established in 1897. After Union, it was known as St Andrews because there was another Roth Park URC, also established in 1897, which had been a congregational church. I'm not quite sure what it says, but we could find a Presbyterian church called Roth Park Church and a congregational church called Roth Park Church, both established in 1897. And what it said years later when both ended up in the URC. All three were known locally as the Scottish Church, founded by Scots and operating as centres of Scottish culture, which included dancing, bagpipe bands, wearing of the kilt on special occasions. This is quite a different experience to most, if not all, of Wales's congregational churches, and some admitted finding it strange. In a recent magazine for City Church, formerly Windsor Place in Cardiff, there are reminiscences of an older member who admits to being, and I quote, puzzled over a Presbyterian Church of England founded by Scotsmen in a city of Wales. It's worth noting that Bernard Knox recorded the story of a fourth congregation of the Presbyterian Church of England, which was found of all places in Aberdare. Almost as soon as the laying of a foundation was stone for a new church, a student of Trevecca College, one John Evans, was called and inducted in July 1868. Initially then, the church belonged to the Calvinistic Methodist connection. But by 1875, and we don't quite know why, Evans was petitioning to join the Presbyterian Church in England, making clear that the congregation at Aberdeen intended to follow suit. Evans and the congregation were received into the Presbytery of Birmingham in October that year. The Welsh Calvinistic Methodist Association then decided they needed to secure ownership of the building, which they did, and they established an English-speaking congregation in the town. Nevertheless, the Presbyterian Church of England by then had established its own building by June 1879. This was decidedly not a congregation of expatriate Scots. This church was not St. Andrew's, nor was it St. Columba's. It was St. David's. As might be imagined, it proved difficult to sustain quite so many English-speaking churches in Aberdeen. There was also an English Congregational and Baptist church. By then belonging to the Presbytery of Bristol, the church was dissolved by the Presbytery in 1952. What is perhaps remarkable about that, though, is that if you look at the 1951-52 handbook of the Presbyterian Church of England, it lists that the church had 53 communicants, a full list of officers, and a minister, somebody called the Revd W.H. Redwin. Now, the written record could hide all sorts of issues, but it sounds, from this distance, as rather a large church. Mr. Redwin disappeared from the Presbyterian records at this point. He was a student of this college prior to his ordination. That though then being said, the new church in Wales was overwhelmingly congregational. The more detailed information given in the first denominational yearbook reveals an increase to 172 churches. Around 20, including my home church, applied to join after the official union. As far as the number of churches were concerned, the Wales province was larger than East Midlands, Mersey, and Northern, and was only one short of Yorkshire. With 12,675 members, Wales was ahead of East Midlands, Eastern, and South West provinces. But with 5,138 children, it lagged behind every other province. At this point in time, there were 33 churches whose membership fell between 100 and 199. There were three with a membership between 200 and 299. Two had a membership between 300 and 399, including my own church, which was 399 at the time. And two with a membership between 400 and 500, the largest membership in the province being that of Christ Church in Brill. This left 132 churches with a membership under 100, of which 27 had a membership between 10 and 20, and 6 had a membership in single figures. 8 seems to have been the most popular figure. 50 years later, the 2022 yearbook paints a different picture. There are now 84 churches listed as part of the National Synod. I know that there's sort of differences in between, and I know that my mathematics have proven bad already, but I think that's a decline of around 49%. This still puts the Synod ahead of those of Mersey, Northern, and Scotland, which of course there was no United Reformed Church in 1972. Its membership is now 1,589, which I think, and I'll get somebody with the skills necessary to check, is a decline of around 88%. As far as membership is concerned, that places the Synod at the bottom of the table. Only one church, that's Beulah in Trevina, which had the second largest membership in 1973, now has a membership over 100 at 135. 36 churches are in local ecumenical partnerships, 11 with the Presbyterian Church of Wales, 10 with the Methodist Church, one each with the Union of Welsh Independents, Baptists and Congregational Federation, and six where three, four, or five denominations for a local ecumenical partnership. If we count the LEPs, the largest membership is at Trinity Church in Potkawl with 154, while the United Church Sketty in Swansea also has a combined total of 100. We don't count LEPs where the URC membership is at 20 or under. Single URCs with between 10 and 20 members, now number 17, and another 19 have less than 10. The lowest membership is recorded for Pontyprennau, a community church on the estate in East Cardiff with Baptist Church in Wales, Methodist Church, Presbyterian Church of Wales involvement. The total membership is recorded in the yearbook as zero. Happily, there is an average in-person congregation of 26. The pastorates are served by 11 URC ministers, though the church has also received ministry from 7 Methodists, 3 Presbyterian Church of Wales ministers, 2 Baptist ministers, 1 Church of Scotland minister, 3 URC lay leaders, 1 Baptist lay leader, and there's 1 CRCW serving project in Swansea. The pattern of ministry, the number of ministers is much smaller, is much more varied in 2022. It was in 1972. There is one church in the Synod which records a higher membership in 2022 than in 1972. There's always a good story somewhere if you look deep enough. And this is the historic church of Maeseronen in Powys. The increase is not huge. There were 12 members at Union, there are 13 today. More intriguing for me is the fact that the church has become younger over the last 50 years. Its foundation in 1972 was recorded as 1640, but in 2022 it's recorded as 1697. This is a change that justifies yet another jubilee, and I think they're celebrating that this summer. It seems that 1640 is an estimate of the foundation of the independent congregation which met secretly in a nearby barn until the conversion of the buildings at Maeseronen, but the registration of the place as a place of worship came in 1697 under the terms of the 1689 Toleration Act. Now, statistics alone paint a fairly gloomy picture. Indeed, there's evidence to suggest that the mentality of decline was firmly planted in the Welsh Prophets at its inauguration, with a moderator neither an encourager the churches nor an advocate for the new church. John Morgans, at the time a minister in Llanidloes in Mid Wales, recorded in his diary for March 1971, at the provincial committee meeting at Newtown, the moderator gave a very dismal report on our denomination. The one fact I remembered was that the URC in Wales was in such a decline that the moderator believed it to be terminal. That's in 1972. This seems to have continued Bill Samuel in the United Church. Maybe he was too dyed-in-the-wool a congregation as to have any interest in promoting the new church or seeking to understand its ethos. In the 1970s, there seemed a genuine possibility for union between the United Reformed Church in Wales and the Eastern Association of the Presbyterian Church in Wales, which is the English-speaking association of the church. One stumbling block on the Presbyterian side was the office of the moderator, and what was considered its potential for prelacy. This emerged in a discussion in November 1977, which Morgans noted, and this is an instance where you really don't want your predecessor in the same meeting as you, to the moderator, I guess. Bill did not help. When he said that a moderator was a kind of bishop, in fact, a benevolent dictator. What if he chose not to be benevolent? Are there checks and balances? He wrote. He says then that he went on to explain the URC's stand on the office and recorded the atmosphere improved. To be honest, it's unlikely that union was ever really going to occur with the Presbyterian Church of Wales because of this issue of personal oversight in the episcopacy. And the question would reoccur later in the attempts to establish an ecumenical bishop in East Cardiff, where the Presbyterian Church of Wales was initially part of the negotiation, but eventually withdrew because of the same issue. Now, I wrote at this point, I'm running out of time, so I want to make some brief points in closing. I am running out of time, but this reflected when I was writing it about 45 minutes ago. In the years after the retirement of Bill Sam, there were concerted initiatives to create a synod structure to recruit ministers. There were provincial and later synod days which brought people from all over Wales together in a celebratory and uplifting fashion. In 1987, the province of Wales managed to persuade the United Home Church to come to Wales General Assembly, which held in St David's Hall in Cardiff, the first time the assembly had been held in England. There was a massive celebration at the time to which all the churches were invited, and I remember going along, and I don't remember much about it except that I had been asked to play a rugby player, and I had to stand domineering fashion over a much shorter boy who was playing a chapel deacon. I don't know what it is about me that I'm apparently picked to play a rugby player, because I never played rugby in my life. The URC has also played a full part in the ecumenical life of Wales, and Gareth can say more about that because he's been central to a lot of that over the last period. Through being a signatory to the covenant in 1975, supporting the proposal to consecrate the ecumenical bishop in Cardiff, participating in talks to propose a structure for a uniting church, observing the conversation seeking to establish a united free church. Much energy was expended, much disappointment experienced. Local ecumenical partnerships have had mixed fortunes as new appointments were made of those more committed to denominational survival and ecumenical endeavour. However people understood the URC in Wales in 1972, I think there is something to be said for the resilience and faithfulness that, despite everything, particularly the cruel and relentless decline we've all experienced, we are still here. I know that from a 1972 perspective, that might appear a sad conclusion to the thing, but from our perspective now, we have at least remained faithful for 50 years. Mm-hmm. Much in Welsh URCs will look like many English URCs, not all of them, I know, but a lot of them. But the experience of living in a devolved nation with historic nonconformist traditions, whose story is different, living with a culture and language that is different to England, produces a different character, even coming down to the fact that familiar hymns are sung to different tunes, and they're not all in the minor key. Probably still the same people wearing different hats. I think we are more likely to be different people wearing different hats, and for that, we can thank God for your seeing those. Thank you.